spot.
Yeah, I'll on this.
Someone else?
Here?
Doing camera?
They're supposed to be on
camera. By the way, that's a cool
computer. How much do you pay?
I kept my lifeboat's box, and I ended up making it here like 3 years later.
Yeah.
It was so well designed, it was just a beautiful Japanese box.
Joey, what was that?
I was saying, I put a computer in the box, so I bought a laptop in like 3 years before.
So when I put this session on the Penta schedule, are you all good over and happy over there in the corner? Really good?
Yeah.
Okay, great. So when I originally stuck this session on the proposed sessions system eons ago, it seems, my original thought was that it might be fun to do this sort of at the beginning of the week, and if folks were inspired and thought there were cool things they had seen, that they could go hack around and maybe actually try some software out on my hardware while we're here. But that obviously isn't how this all worked out. I'm just tickled that all of you thought this was a good way to spend a little time on the afternoon of the last day of the adventure. Am I on your court?
You are.
Is that better?
Thank you, sir.
You're welcome.
I'm not murdering anyone.
I'm doing my best to flatten everything that I can sit on. So, in any case, there's like, I've been accreting information from different sources for this general topic of software-defined radio, and for quite some time. And so I actually have a slide deck here that's overloaded with lots of interesting stuff. And rather than frantically try to zoom through a slide deck and give you no time on any of it, I will instead promise to make this deck available as I do all of my others sometime soon on one or more of the sites where you can download it. And so what I'd like to start off with is get some sort of sense of what you're interested in and what we ought to spend the next hour and 45 or so talking about. I do want to try and close a couple minutes earlier than the schedule suggested we might, because I'm very interested to see what happens in this lightning talk session, which I think starts at 3:45-ish or something like that. So I'm feeling very flexible about all this. I'm happy to hang around and talk and play and show and tell as long as anybody wants. But I thought that looked like an interesting session, so let's see if that works out. So there are sort of several chunks of stuff that I have here. There's some neat hardware bits and pieces that enable you to play with software-defined radio, because as much as we might like, it's not a 100% cool software thing. There are interesting political aspects of the whole software-defined radio space. In particular, challenges before our national communications regulatory bodies about how to handle the balance between making it possible for people to experiment with new technologies and new methods, and the need to regulate things, particularly for public health and safety and communications. There's also the specifics of the GNU Radio software and how that gets packaged for Debian and all of the Debian derivatives. And then there's just sort of goofy, fun, show and tell things. Gail thinks it's fun to use software-defined radio, including bouncing signals off the moon and tracking amateur rocketry flights and all sorts of other things we could talk about. So first of all, how many of you have ever done any sort of digital signal processing or software-defined radio stuff? Took a class in college, even? Okay, not many. Okay, so clearly a little bit of what this is about and basic background would be in order. Give me a sense of bias. How many of you are more interested in sort of the politics of this and cool things you can do and how it fits in the larger scheme of things versus the alternative, which is you actually like to do stuff and you'd like more nuts and bolts kind of things?
Second
part.
Second part.
Okay. And some of both. Okay. All right, well, I'm going to hop around a bunch then, and I'll try and have this be reasonably coherent. If it's not, you know, if it feels like I'm missing something or something's confusing, please jump right in. With this size room, this many people, I think we can be reasonably interactive and shouldn't have some huge problems. So I have the stuff that I have in this slide deck includes sort of some fundamental concepts of software-defined radio, a little bit about the GNU Radio project, because that's one of several large, but perhaps the preeminent code base for actually doing stuff. And it's one that I happen to personally be engaged with. In fact, I was very pleased the other day to receive finally explicit permission from my employer to do the necessary copyright assignment paperwork with the FSF. So I'll be getting committer access to the upstream archive to help ensure that things that matter as we're doing Debian packaging and trying to make all the contributed examples actually work and that sort of stuff. I'll be able to work on that more directly in the future, I hope. I've got some stuff in here about the politics of open source software-defined radio. And it's interesting with the intersection of open source and software-defined everything seems to generate interesting political questions and problems. And I think that's worth talking about a little bit. I brought a couple of pieces of hardware. Not some of the most recent things, actually, but the most recent ones, A, I haven't had a whole lot of time to play with them yet, and B, I'm a little bigger. Don't put me over here, been on the airplane quite as well. But I'll talk about interesting hardware stuff, and then I can show you some examples. We can try some demos. Sometimes they work well, sometimes they don't work at all. So this is sort of the block diagram of a typical data radio transceiver. And when you look, So again, I apologize, I'm having a little bit clipped on the right. All you're losing here is the rest of the words, data out at the top and data in at the bottom. The basic notion is you've got this antenna over on the left-hand side, there's some filtering, things that look like sideways triangles or amplifiers. And so in the receive chain on the top, you take the signal in from the antenna, you do a little bit of front-end filtering, it goes through an amplifier, gets filtered again, circle and cross, and it's a mixer. That takes two frequencies in and gives you the sum and difference of them out. And with another filter, you can pick which one of those two mixing products you want. You amplify it a bunch. There's this little thing called DMOD up there that demodulates the waveform. You basically get bits coming out from left to right. And on the transmit side, it's very similar. You take data in, you may do some waveform shaping. In effect, in this particular example, it's being used to control, there's a little piece of what's, there's a line missing on there too, sorry. There's a piece in effect that's controlling which of the transmitter receive oscillators is being used. There's a phase lock loop circuit there in the middle that is locking that reference oscillator to produce the frequencies that are being mixed with. And on the transmit side, you're basically just modulating an oscillator, amplifying it, and out through the filters to the antenna. So this is sort of what a typical data transceiver looks like these days. And if you open up, you know, any kind of radio device, you'll see all sorts of analog electronic components in. These filters are implemented with inductors and capacitors and resistors, and amplifiers are usually either transistor circuits or operational amplifiers, or more recently things like MMICs, which are little microwave monolithic integrated circuits. A lot of times big chunks of this are integrated, so the whole PLL and oscillator thing might be one mega chip from somebody. But there's a lot of complex analog circuitry out there. This is what we'd like to have. And ooh, my half-tone stuff isn't showing up well. Basic idea, antenna through some simple RF front end to an analog to digital converter, at which point it's all bits and your code goes there. On the transmit side, code generating bits which go through a digital to analog converter, a little bit of amplification and filtering and out to the antenna. Now, unfortunately, you know, nothing's ever quite that simple, but the notion is get the bits as close to the antenna as possible. On the receive side, you want to get from RF to data, and on the transmit side, you want to get from data to RF as close to the antenna with as little analog stuff in the way as you can. So what can you do with this? Well, you can do all the sort of conventional radio stuff. One of the cool things is if you have, there's a quote down here from somebody playing with a particular type of software-defined radio that's popular in the ham radio world. This is that usements just don't exist. You get a brand new radio every time you download the latest software. And so feature sets, modulation schemes, filter performance, all of those things that, you know, I don't know how many of you are old enough. There's a point in history where when you went to buy a radio, they actually told you how many transistors it had in it on the outside of the radio. This was a 7-transistor AM radio or 13-transistor radio or something. It was really exciting to have more stuff in the radio. And then there was a period where, oh, you know, this one gets 4 shortwave bands and, you know, 2 medium wave bands. And with software defined radio, it's sort of, you know, is your A to D and D to A, are they good enough? And is the little bit of analog electronics you still have to have good enough? And beyond that, it really is just a software and programming problem. And it's possible to, so continuous enhancement, it's also possible to achieve performance that's just not possible in analog circuits. Any of you ever took an analog electronics class will remember that whole section they made you plow through about filters and about the quality of a filter and the gain of the filter and the ripple and the passband of the filter. Well, with software-defined radio techniques, you can have filters that really do just look like they have square edges. They have a nice flat gain through the passband, and they, you know, get cut off amazing numbers of octaves in short numbers of in short distances on either side of the interesting thing. You really can do things in software that's just not possible to do with analog electronics. There's this other interesting thing that happens that in digital communication systems, there's sort of this triad of bandwidth, time, and power. And if you want to improve the quality of a link, you can actually consume more bandwidth, spread the signal, use coding techniques, or you can transmit the same piece of information over a longer period of time, which might mean going to a lower data rate. It might mean repeating the data more than once as part of some forward error correcting scheme. Or you can crank the power up. And what's interesting with software-defined radio techniques is that you often have an easier opportunity to make these trade-offs and to use more bandwidth and more time because it's under computer control and all the software is involved. There are all sorts of other things you can do. I think this notion of cognitive radio is a really interesting idea, and it's one that lots of people talk about and still to be fully explored, which is this notion of you have a radio and it comes up on a band and there's some interesting signal there and the radio figures out what the modulation scheme is and the radio figures out that, well, to talk to that person today, we ought to use this kind of a modulation scheme, this kind of a power level and so forth. We see little bits of this today. All of you that have GSM mobile phones, they all did power control. And the way they did that is the cell site that you're talking to is monitoring your signal quality and you're reporting to it the quality of signal that you're receiving. And there's this little protocol dance going on quietly in the background as they figure out how to power control each other so that you don't overload the central site with a stronger signal than it really needs, which would make it harder for it to hear all the other handsets and so forth. And making all of those things work cooperatively together well is why sometimes we end up with regulatory issues that surround this that we have to navigate. So then what's GNU Radio? Well, it's a free software toolkit for building and deploying software-defined radio things. It's also a really great way to learn about digital signal processing. I should mention that, you know, 20 years ago, everybody talked about digital signal processing. Well, today, more likely, you'll still hear about that, particularly in the instrumentation kind of realm. But when it comes to communications, the thing we call software-defined radio is sort of a combination of digital signal processing and other techniques. It's kind of a superset of that. If you're going to do useful stuff, you do have to learn something about communication systems. You have to, you know, you can't magically go, ah, I want a transmitter. It's not quite that simple. There are a bunch of programming examples with the GNU Radio stuff that will help you get started. But kind of have to understand what a modulator is, what a demodulator is, you know, what analog and digital conversion is about. And there are really great textbooks out there that are used in things like college level signal processing classes that can be very helpful. But a lot of folks just, you know, it's the same way with other open source projects. They'll go look at some existing examples, ask some questions, try some things, experiment. But the exciting stuff is you really can create all sorts of new radios, modulations, protocols, development environments, and just explore and do cool stuff that you might not be able to afford to or have access to the technology to work with otherwise. So I'm not going to spend a whole lot of time on this, but the general notion is that this is sort of a hybrid system where the actual signal processing guts are implemented as efficiently as possible in C++. And then there's a Python interface that's exposed. So you stitch together actual radios by instantiating these various modules from or objects in a C++ environment. And they all get sort of tied together using this data flow abstraction. So you have this notion that I have this source of data over here, and I'm, you know, connecting its output to the input of something else, and its output to the input of something else. And sometimes you have multiplexing or demultiplexing or splitting or combining blocks. And you could do this, I mean, conceptually, it's sort of a, you could think of it visually, but in practice, I want to show you an example which is really pretty straightforward. And the nice thing about this is there's sort of a separation between the signal processing wizardly foo that has to go in and create blocks and put them into the new radio system, and what it takes to actually sort of connect them together and go and sort of think in terms of, I need a filter with these characteristics, without necessarily having to understand all the GUI code that's going on underneath to make that work. It is more involved to create new blocks, but if you get interested in that and there's a block you want that isn't already there, there's a very vibrant community that is happy to help you figure that out. So here's like a little example. Bonus points to anybody who can tell me what this does. You're losing two arguments on the ends of the six source lines, but I don't know if any of you have been around long enough or care. Actually, it's also sort of a US example. What's going on here is really simple. We're instantiating two signal sources here, source 0 and source 1. They're oscillators that are being defined to have a pair of audio frequencies, and they're being connected together to an audio sync.
They're pressing a button on the phone.
It's a dial thing. It's what you're hearing.
In stereo.
Let me see if I can remember where I parked that. That's the very foreground one, so you didn't really want more of them, did you? It's harder to hear, though, isn't it?
I didn't know that song.
Yeah, so, I mean, it really, and by the way, just so you don't believe there's something weird going on here, what's the thing, shift control of the bus? Just so you have some idea, this really is, okay, so there's a couple of commands to your process, but there's that same data I was just showing you, and that's all I'm doing. So it gets more interesting when you have real hardware to use and so forth, but we'll get to that. So there's this other thing that goes on that you have to mention, and when we're talking about software-defined radio, a lot of times what we hear about are these sort of political issues. And in particular, there are problems with the fact that today a lot of wireless network interfaces and notebooks are actually implemented using software-defined radio techniques. And it's because they're implemented in software-defined radio techniques that we get a lot of the cool features we get for the price points that we get. But it also is the reason that it's really hard to get a 100% open source wireless interface in a notebook these days, because there are regulatory bodies in various countries around the world. I keep being told, though I don't know the details, that Japan is a particularly sticky place in this regard, that really don't want end users to be able to twiddle the knobs on the radio too much. And so there are regulatory requirements on what interfaces people can expose if they want to be able to sell these pieces of hardware. And this is why I think, at least for the near term, we're going to be stuck in a world where we have some binary downloadable firmware for wireless cards, and we don't get full exposure of the hardware interface. It's too bad, because there's all kinds of cool things you can do if you can program the radio hardware that's directly in either the Wi-Fi interface, or more interestingly, at least right now, in the US with the sort of cell phone card radio interfaces that are built into the machine. But, you know, what we can do, and what we can't. But what ends up happening here is that this isn't a simple one-way thing. It's not one of those freedom is good and we deserve this and they're being mean to us kind of problems. It's much more complicated than that. And the reason it's more complicated is that as a society we have to balance this concept of freedom to innovate against useful kinds of control. And I think one of the best examples is really what happens when we're talking about public safety communications. I've had the experience in the past of traveling around with people who do things like provide the emergency communications for search and rescue teams up in the mountains in Colorado. And it's not unusual for those guys to have a vehicle with 7 or 8 or 9 different radio systems installed in the vehicle. And these are all different agencies that have different spectrum allocations and different vintages of equipment and modulation schemes and all this. And it's tempting to think of, you know, well, could we just have one box that you put in there and, you know, that understood all these modulation schemes and frequencies and use more software-defined techniques? And yes, that would be a benefit. But then you turn around and you say, and what happens if there's one guy sitting in his unmarked sedan out in the corner of the parking lot with a jamming transmitter that, you know, works really well because he's got all the same software-defined techniques and he's preventing these public service guys from being able to talk to each other and go rescue somebody who's in dire straits. And so I think there are legitimate reasons for regulatory bodies to want to be able to control some aspects of this stuff. And the trick is just for us to find what the right balances are. I don't know what it is. Certainly through history, part of the motivation for the Inner Radio Project has been things like the broadcast flag that I'm sure many of you heard about on high definition TV broadcast, and the way that sort of intersects with the Digital Millennium Copyright Act in the U.S. in this notion that this is a mechanism for protecting content, and if you reverse engineer it, you've, you know, done something illegal. And yet, you know, we're in a situation where if you follow the way that was originally defined, there would be no provisions for fair use of those streams at all. And the good news is there was a court ruling in the U.S. that said that the Federal Communications Commission only has the right to regulate the part that's going over the airwaves and through the transmission networks, and once the content's received, that they don't have the power to regulate that. Of course, immediately, there was then a request filed with our Congress to, you know, write a new law that gives them a different set of power. So this is an ongoing thing. It's not a one-shot deal. It's not a, oh, we won the war, oh, we lost. But it's something where we have to successfully educate policymakers and decision makers that this is one of those places where there's an opportunity for innovation and invention and for people to experiment with and do cool new things. And yes, it needs to be balanced with, you know, whether the behaviors at the end of the day are in the public good or not. But it has been the case in the past, and I think it's still true, at least some branches of the code tree, that on the new radio stuff can do a full software decode to modulate and display of high-def TV broadcasts. But frankly, ever since the broadcast flag stuff progressed, that's been a less exciting thing. So okay, so if you want to actually play around with this, in that block diagram, I show that you have to kind of get from the RF world in and out of the computer. And to do that, you need analog to digital and digital to analog conversion. And depending on what kinds of A to Bs and D to H you have, you may also have a need for some simple pieces of RF electronics to get yourself converted up and down from the frequency bands that are really of interest to you. And within the sort of amateur software-defined radio community, which is to date largely been around the amateur radio world, though there are university projects doing cool things and other people as well, there are really sort of two main approaches to this. One is to figure out how to do things with sound cards, and in particular, to in effect sort of do the modulation and demodulation part, but not necessarily a whole lot of the radio part in software-defined radio. And then the other approach has been to have higher speed data interfaces, like USB 2.0, which these boards use, and to have higher speed A to D and D to A converters that are dealing with frequencies that get at least up into the IF range, if not all the way to RF. So if you're doing sound card interfacing, the good thing about sound cards is lots of people have them, and they're cheap. And the bad part, in some sense, is that you can really only use these with narrow and low frequency IFs. It's really good if what you want to do is listen into something like a paging data stream, or if you want to, I don't know. We've talked about all sorts of interesting position reporting and locating systems. If you want to make it possible for anybody with a notebook and a scanner to be able to listen to and decode the data stream that's coming down from, you know, your high-powered model rocket that you just launched, so they can help you refine it. There are things like this that work really well. In the ham radio community, there are a lot of people doing things like this. There's this modulation scheme called PSK31. It's actually a 31 and a half baud communications mechanism, which is really, really slow, right? But with PSK31, I have sat at my parents' beach house on the Outer Banks of North Carolina with a short wire antenna thumbtacked to the railing of the deck a few feet off the beach, a 15 or 20 watt transmitter and a notebook computer, and successfully contacted people in 23 countries in 3 days, including New Caledonia, which is more than 12,000 miles of that path. So, and what you end up doing is you're just sitting there on a keyboard to keyboard typing with each other. Think, you know, person to person, you know, IRC message or query kind of stuff, right? Every once in a while, a few characters are garbled, but your brain doesn't care because, you know, maybe the other person just doesn't type that well. And so whether it's actually being lost in the RF or they just can't type, you know, your brain sort of integrates this, and you can have a really good time and have nice conversations with people. And there's no infrastructure involved. There's no internet. There's no telcos. You're not paying, you know.
Peer-to-peer IRC.
It's basically point-to-point communicating directly with other people across political, geographic, national boundaries and all this. And there's a coolness factor there, even today.
And it's too slow for flameballs.
And it's really too slow. You make a good point.
In certain countries, you're not allowed to discuss sensitive things.
Well, and there are, I don't know, we won't go down that rabbit hole, but there are, the interesting thing to me about this is that there are so many people around the world that are interested in ham radio who are not good at typing. A lot of the programs people use for PSK31 have these big macro facilities. And you can define, you know, here's the complete description of all the equipment that I'm using in my station. And here's the complete description of where I live and how far I am north of such and such little town you've never heard of in Ukraine. And, you know, here's where all of my kids are currently going to school. And they'll sit there and sort of, you know, push a button, and then it takes, I don't know, 3 minutes or something for that to all get done. So it's interesting that if you're in a contest situation or something, as people are going for the maximum number of contacts, that's sort of interesting because they're really quick and short exchanges and kind of content free on some level. And then there are these, just sort of sitting around on a random evening, having these long and often relevant content conversations. But then there's also the case where you run into somebody who's really interesting. You know, like the guy I talked to one evening was on Montserrat Island doing some consulting work. And we had, I don't know, an hour and a half conversation until the RF connection we had finally sort of faded due to change in conditions in the ionosphere. But this is a total hoot talking to him. And so these are things that are just fun. But there are also other things that people are doing as well. So this is the guts of this thing called an STR-1000. I don't actually have one of those with me, but it's a small board stack that implements hardware that allows you to get from the sound card interface on and off the HF amateur radio bands very easily. And in fact, having this one clips a little more challenging, but it basically gives you a receiver that's good up to about 65 megahertz, and will transmit on the HF ham radio band. And it's possible to have it with up to 100 watt transmitter, though there are all kinds of features on this now. But the thing, for those of you that know anything about filters, the fact that you can have a 25 hertz wide Morse code receive filter that doesn't ring at all, it's a really crisp, almost perfect filter, is kind of mind-boggling. And the software features on this just keep evolving. This is kind of what the box looks like. It's, I don't know, it's about this big. So it's not totally tiny, but it's in effect a complete HF transceiver equivalent to the multi-thousand dollar Japanese and German made transceivers. It's well under $1,000 and interfaces with a sound card, and you can use some really neat stuff with it. And there are people playing around. This is one of the user interfaces that somebody coddled up as a, you know, sort of look more like a communications receiver on your screen. So then the thing I personally spend more time with is wideband I.O., this notion that it'd be fun to do things a little more directly at RF, and where it would be fun to be able to experiment with wider bandwidth modulation schemes than people normally play with on the HF bands. And some of the earliest experiments that people were doing were with PCI bus plug-in cards that had A to Ds and D to As. The problem is those are usually made for use in industrial automation, process control, prototyping. As a result, they're very expensive. And you still need an RF front end, because that's just the A to Ds and D to As. So more recently, meaning in the last 4 years, there's kind of focus on building things with USB 2.0 interfaces as a cheaper and more reasonable way to get into this. There are now people sort of fanning out again, and there's discussion about, you know, other interfaces that are becoming common on computers, but personally, the things I'm playing with are still mostly USB stuff. So one of the things I have with me is one of these SSRP kits, which is a David Carr design, this little daughter card, and underneath it is, I'm holding it apart for a sec. Underneath is a board that came from somewhere in Eastern Europe, actually, that's just a developer's evaluation board for one of the Cypress USB 2.0 microcontrollers. It's basically a USB connector, a microcontroller, a crystal connector, and two passive components on a power supply part. And then this daughter card is the software-defined radio piece, and all it really, this is a receive-only system, no transmit side at all. He's claimed for a while to be working on an equivalent transmit board, but I haven't actually seen any of the parts being made available yet. So this one basically has a connector for hooking up an antenna or feed line or something, an amplifier and an A to D with some filtering, and an A to D converter, and this big can is a crystal that sets the sampling frequency. And so this can be used to get RF sampled and into the computer as data. Actually, just over here, might pass that around and look at it. It's reasonably robust, you know, don't go mashing it.
How much is that, did you say?
You know, I don't remember. I think the little microprocessor eval board was in the like under $50 US range, and I think I just got the bare circuit boards for the daughter card from David, and I think I paid him $10 or $15 each for them. The A to D converter and the amplifier that are on there are routinely available, at least in the US, as free samples from the manufacturers if you ask them nicely and have something that looks like a business address. So.
Or academic.
Or academic. And in fact, it's interesting because this whole free samples thing, you might feel like it's a scam or something to be telling them you want this for hobby things, but every time I've ever talked to people at those companies, they're actually pretty enthusiastic about folks like us getting a free part or two and playing with them, because it builds the body of knowledge and people end up actually occasionally building a product and buying tens of thousands of units as a result. So that's just part of the dynamic about that. I always, I never lie to people when I'm requesting free samples. If they have the thing and it says, is this for a product that's about to go into production, that's clearly not the box to check. The one down here, you know, I'm thinking about it or evaluating technology or something, that's a good box to check. When they say, you know, how many units might you buy in the next year, I always pick whatever the lowest volume one is, you know, the 0 to 100 units or something. I figure if they still want to send me the parts, then they must really want me to vote. There's another thing that this Vladimir fellow, who I don't know very well, did, that's kind of an SSRP equivalent. There's the USRP board, which I have here that I'll talk about a little bit more, that Matt Edis did, and then there's the newer high-performance software-defined radio project, which, by the way, those of you with notebooks that want to go surfing ahead, that's hpsdr.org, and there's some cool stuff there. So anyway, this, for those of you who haven't seen it yet, this is that SSRP board. This is the microcontroller board that goes with it, and that's the daughter card. And once again, sorry for being a little clipped on the right. My notebook, despite Keith P. Fu, and this projector are not entirely happy with each other. But there's an SMA connector on the lower left. That's the antenna connector. The part, little black part just above it with 8 leads, is a instrumentation amplifier. It's a high quality amplifier. The passive components behind that implement some filtering going into that linear technology Z to D chip. And it's basically just, you know, sampling that RF and giving me numbers out representing the amplitude of that signal on regular intervals. They get passed back over USB 2 to the computer. And the problem,
how much of that, the hardware's RF specific versus just a plain analog sample, or some other kind of analog sample?
The only thing that really ends up being RF specific is the very front end where you're getting a little bit of signal conditioning. So one of the things we want with RF a lot of times is the ability to sample right down to 0 hertz. So DC offsets and whether you're AC or DC coupled to DA to D converter, things like that matter. They don't often matter as much to people who are doing pure instrumentation stuff. So this works and it's kind of cool, but the problem with this kind of interface is that you're generating a pretty hefty data stream as you start to go up in frequency. Because there's no logic on here to decimate the sample. I mean, if I put an oscillator in, I don't know what the one is that's in there, it's probably 16 megahertz or something, you're going to get samples that often. And the computer's got to be able to eat that data stream coming in over the bus and do something useful with it. And if what you're really trying to do is, decode the audio to figure out what the combination is to that one, there are a lot of things that you might want to do that don't need a lot of bandwidth, and so you end up consuming a lot of computer resources that you don't necessarily need with a dumb-ish interface like this. The reason this whole software-defined radio thing makes so much sense, though, is that Moore's Law and the economies of scale mean that the computers we have and the abilities that we have that come with them, and because of our buddies doing gaming and graphics and so forth, the cool signal processing-ish instructions that are buried in common processors from Intel and AMD these days are just stunning for doing software-defined radio stuff. So it's amazing how much you really can do with a generic notebook and these sorts of interfaces. But at the same time, this is a relatively simplistic interface. It's just an A to D converter that generates a big stream of data.
Aren't you going to have problems pushing that much over the USB? That was more or less my problem in time.
Well, this is why this ends up being sort of limited in the end. This is Vladimir's board. It's very much like the SSRP. It's got an analog devices converter, and then the big black part is the USB 2.0 microcontroller. The other side of his board is pretty boring. Mm-hmm. Crystal, a few resistors and caps, an LED, some connectors, not a whole lot to it. In fact, his headers down here mostly to get access to other pins on the processor to play with. I don't know what the status of this board is. I've never really known, but it struck me at one point that it would be kind of cool if somebody just made a bunch of these for folks to play with. But
I mean, it's like that one's hand-done with chemical etching rather than a print PCB.
Yeah. This guy's in, I forget where he's in, some interesting part of the world that doesn't have as easy access to some of the services as we do. In the U.S., at least, you can upload a design file to any of a number of little companies that will take $50 or $60 or $100 U.S. from you and deliver a prototype multi-layer boards back in 2 days or 3 days. So in fact, you can do that for getting aluminum or steel machined. If you want silk screen front panel artwork done, all kinds, there's a whole, it's almost the resurgence of the ability to hack on hardware stuff, is that a lot of these processes that are hard to do yourself and have intimidated people, even surface mount assembly and so forth, there are a lot of little companies now that have popped up and have a web interface and get a credit card and are passionate about something. Within a few days, you can get things turned around it's that personal version of outsourcing processes to other places. It's kind of cool. So then, the USRP, which is this board, and this one has some dark cards on it, was sort of the next evolutionary step. And this is a really, in fact, the SSRP, David Carr did that because it was taking a while for Matt to get the USRP done, and David wanted to play in the meantime or something like that. But this board is really neat because I've got some photos. I'm going to pass it over to figure this out just from looking at a distance. But what this has is the same USB 2.0 microcontroller, a couple of dual A to D, A to A parts from analog devices, and a big honking Altera part in the middle of the board. The Altera part is a field programmable gate array that's soft programmable. So when you first plug this board in on a USB interface, it comes up dumb. And you download firmware to the microcontroller, part of which is the bitstream that you want to put into the FPGA. And then it does a USB reset and re-identifies itself as a USRP with a particular firmware load, and off you go to the races. What's cool about this is that you can implement some of the high processing load front-end functionality in this FPGA. So that the amount of data that's going back and forth over the USB bus is sort of what's important for the thing that you're trying to implement. And the really sweet thing for folks like me, even though I've done FPGA design work before, it's never been something I've really enjoyed. There are a couple of standard loads of functionality for the FPGA that do routine, useful stuff that are available in the GNU Radio Tree so that you don't actually have to become an FPGA programming wizard to take advantage of that. And then the different daughter cards that are on here have different kinds of interfaces. This one with the shiny aluminum can on it is actually a UHF TV tuner that has an F connector, US ridiculous RF connector. I don't know if you're stuck with this junk in this part of the world or not, but you plug an antenna in here, and this covers up to, 860 megahertz or something like that, and it'll down convert, and then basically the output of that is being fed into the A to D. These boards are called basic RX and basic TX boards. They just have connectors and little pulse transformers to isolate the RF connectors from the A to D a little bit. And all these other headers are actually so that you can plug logic analyzer probes on here if you want to, if you're trying to do things like debug what's happening in the FPGA or otherwise are interested in doing more sophisticated work with them. And in fact, if we try to play with this a little bit today, it'll mostly be with the basic daughter cards because there's some cool things you can do even if you don't have any RF gear out.
How many gates can you put in that FPGA?
I think this is a 100K gauge piece, but I wouldn't swear to that. I'm not an expert on the welcome to pull cyclone and go look it up. This is the kind of stuff that's in one of the standard loads, and again, sorry the outlines of a couple boxes are missing here, but it's, they're basically some oscillators implemented in what, did everybody get a chance to look at this or did it not get around? Did you guys all get a chance? Okay, back there?
Cool.
Okay, fine. And there's some decimation going. This is the notion that you can run the A to D converter at a high sample rate, but then only take every nth sample to send back to the computer. Because one of the things that I think people forget is, even if you had a signal processing class and learned about the Nyquist rule that says that the bandwidth of the thing you're sampling is the sample rate, that's bandwidth, not frequency. And so a lot of times it's useful to have a system that will allow you to sample at a higher sampling rate and be able to, in effect, carve out just a small chunk of the bandwidth that you actually want to work with so to minimize the data rate. And the decimation function is what does that. And then on the transmit side, you have a similar sort of interpolation feature that solves the same problem. So here's what one looks like with a couple of the basic transmitting suit daughter cards. And then before we get away from talking about hardware stuff, let me tell you a little bit about the HPSDR stuff. This is an interesting project to me for several reasons, not just the fact that it's software-defined radio. One is, it's one of the first pure open hardware projects I've seen in a while. And what I mean by that is, these guys have gone so far as to motivate an intellectual property lawyer who's former president of Tucson Amateur Packet Radio and pretty well known in this community to create for them an open hardware license. And so there is now a thing called the OHL, the Open Hardware License, and you can think of it as being very GPL-like for hardware designs. And this is something because this community observed the neat effect, the network effect, that happens in the open source world when people agree to share and enjoy and collaborate productively. And they wanted to do the same thing with cool hardware designs. And hardware is just enough different from software in terms of its characteristics and what you need to protect in order to have a meaningful copyleft-ish behavior downstream that they needed a new license. If you're engaged in hobby, hardware hacking and you don't work for a company that has intellectual property concerns that would keep you from being able to do this, I would encourage you to look into the OHL and at least think about it as a possibility. The other thing is these guys are very much, again, interested in creating building blocks that other people can use to do cool things. So the notion here is it's an all-volunteer project creating high-tech modules for experimentation and advancing the radio art. The designs are open source hardware, software, all the programmable logic. And so the translation, it's a bunch of geeks having a good time. And I don't think I need to spend a lot of time on it here, but this notion of open source hardware, if you want to call it that, has been something a lot of folks in this community have had to sort of spend a moment to wrap their brains around. This notion that any changes you make to somebody's design in creating a derivative circuit board, for example, are things that you should be able to share, or you should have to share with people downstream and provide, you know, fixes back to the folks that you got it from. The notion that the design should be freely available to anyone who asks, and it's an interesting concept when you start thinking about this. And what it really comes down to is it's not clear that companies participating in the production of commercial hardware would like this kind of a license at all. It's probably even tougher to contemplate a major corporation directly engaging with an open hardware project than it is today to see major corporations with software patent portfolios participating in open source projects. But who knows, the world may get us there at some point. But what is cool is it says that all these folks that are doing things on their hobby time and learning and from each other in the process are building a body of work that is also shared and can be used to do cool stuff. So this is actually a backplane based design. Those of you who've seen Euro cards before or BME bus stuff will recognize their choice of backplane connector. And the spacing and all is designed so that this could fit in something like an AT PC chassis or an ATX chassis, and the cards would line up in the right order. And it uses an ATX style power supply. This particular board is being powered with one of those little daughter cards that were made for ITX boards and so forth to run them off of DC. But it's an interesting thought. And then there are a couple of boards that are initially available that are interesting. Ozzy is a board that, in effect, provides the equivalent of the logic guts of the USRP, and that its principal purpose is to get, and it's a similar, you know, newer generation of the Cyclone part. The general notion here is a way to come in from some other computer using USB 2 and get onto that backplane and have some of the FPGA-ish kind of functionality. And then Janus is the, in effect, the A to D and D to A converter piece of this. And the reason that this is the first thing that I focused on, and the reason this has been so important, is that I mentioned earlier that one of the nice things about software from radio stuff with sound cards is there's so many of them available. The problem is that so many of them are sheer and utter crap. And if what you want to do is play with PSK31 wired beach or something, it's okay. That's not a super demanding signal processing application. But if you want to do something like weak signal contesting in the amateur radio microwave world or something like that, you really need a better quality radio. And in sound card interface software-defined radio stuff, the quality of the radio and its performance is directly tied to the quality of the sound card. How linear the A to D and D to A behaviors are, how much noise there is, and so forth. And when you go look at some typical commercial sound cards using codecs that are sort of typically used, you see these interesting effects. You notice a little hump in the middle right around 0 hertz. You notice how out towards the edges of the spectrum they're going relatively nonlinear. In fact, the one on the right is just hideously poor once you get out very far. If you're trying to do high performance software defined radio stuff, you can compensate for a little bit of this, but at the end of the day, this is the thing that limits the signal to noise ratio of the system. Therefore, fundamentally, the performance is constrained by the quality of the sound card. This is what's possible if you pick the right A to D parts to build your sound card and you get the signal processing stuff right. So just a quick comparison. Okay, you see? Tiny little spike in the center versus big ass hump in the center. No funny little side spikes around the center versus bunches of them. A nice flat way out to infinity versus, you know, what the heck is that over on the right? It's like a bathtub curve or something.
But it's kind of okay for a sound card to be, you know, flat up to 40 kilohertz and totally screw past that.
Because after all, the human ear has certain intrinsic limitations, and, you know, if we're talking about a sound card, it's...
Is this like when you're sending silence, or is it like... What is the signal you're putting out to the sound card in those drops?
What is the...
Well, I'm trying to find out what are the graphs actually showing besides like frequency.
Okay, so this is frequency across, and I'm pretty sure this is just noise level, but I'd have to go back and look.
Okay, so it shouldn't, okay.
Yeah, wait, is it a single tone with the spike in the middle?
I think so, yeah.
Okay, so you're sending a single tone.
I think that's correct. It
looks like dB or something.
Yeah, and those are dB down from the reference. So then there are other things that people are working on. So those are the parts that are actually available today. Is this, there's basically a three-board set that's available. It's the backplane, the USB interface with the big FPGA, and the thing that looks like a sound card on the other side. And that three-board set gives you the equivalent of a USB-attached, really high-quality sound card for doing stuff up to the 100 kilohertz-ish kind of range, which isn't bad, because with something like an SDR1000 providing a hardware interface to convert up and down to various ham radio bands, the combination of this board set on something like the SDR1000 and your average ham radio user of software-defined radio is going to be pretty happy for a while. But then there are other things going on. This Mercury board is a really fast A to D board that's going to have performance capabilities slightly better than even SRP in its current version. This is another interesting board. I don't know if this one is still live or not. You very quickly get into this mode where there's some things that are clearly building blocks intended to be put together on that backplane, and some of them are projects where the board might end up being something that could plug into that backplane, but they're designed to actually be sort of separable devices. So in this one, you notice there's a CAN bus interface down at the bottom. That's because this might actually fly on a satellite using one of our CAN control interfaces. And you notice it's got a big DSP chip in the middle of it so that it can run standalone without needing to have another processor out there. So some of these combinations get kind of interesting. Also within the high-performance SDR community, there's a lot of interest in precise timing. If you want to do software-defined radio things over long distances with complex modulation schemes, knowing that both ends have their clocks locked to within some number of nanoseconds of a national reference allows you to make assumptions in your modulation schemes and protocols that you couldn't otherwise make. Some of us just like having precise clocks. So there's all sorts of interesting stuff happening here with precise timing interfaces that will be part of the system as well.
Would that be mainly for frequency hopping?
Well, that's one possibility, but you can also imagine for some of the moon bounce things that I'm interested in, what you'd like to be able to do is get really long integration times where you're transmitting a coded signal on a particular frequency. And in order to be able to accumulate energy over a long period of time from that signal, you need to keep the frequency that you're listening to really steady. And you need to know when to be listening to differentiate between when the other guy is transmitting and you should be integrating. When he's not transmitting, and it would just be noise in the bucket. We actually have protocols now for doing things like sending short messages via the moon, where the coding is super intense, and it's possible in software to detect these signals and have communications when the signals are 20 or 30 dB below the noise.
So then you're just doing square root of n noise averaging over a series of samples to increase the...
And you're also doing minimum coding tricks so that the minimum bits from coding tricks so that you figure out what set of messages are you might want to be able to exchange. And you design a coding system that sort of uses a fixed interval of time and uses the maximum coding foo to transmit a really short message with a lot of repetition so that you can integrate over time and pull it up out of noise. There's all kinds of tricks like that. And a lot of those depend on having really stable oscillators and it's prototype expansion boards and stuff like
that. Why bounce off the moon?
Because you can.
For what the reason?
Because it's hard.
Well, also, you can actually, if you bounce off the moon, you can actually talk to someone on the other side of the planet.
So this is true. It's actually one of the little niches of the amateur radio hobby that I find intriguing. And so I have a 3-meter dish that I retrofitted and built an SL mount for in my backyard that is dedicated to doing this kind of weak signal stuff. And it's a total hoot. you know, just sort of going out there and lining the dish up on the moon, getting the radio the right place, and hearing people that you know in Switzerland and Italy and here in the UK, you know, getting each other off the moon. It's just...
How much power do you run off that?
When I get to the point of actually participating in the talking half of this and not just the listening part, I'll be running 500 watts at 1300 megahertz. So, yeah, 500 watts in, into a 3 meter dish, which is 30-ish dB a gain. So,
so don't stand in front of it.
And I have the equivalent to make about 300 watts at 2.4 gigahertz and about 130 watts at 3.5 gigahertz and about 75 watts at 5.7 gigahertz, if I remember correctly.
Please don't do that in front of my laptop.
Do you have the problem of birds falling down roasted?
No, if you do the math on this, the energy density is actually very low. Even you know, a few meters in front of the dish, it's not a problem. It's not like I'm going to be roasting a squab or anything. It also helps that I live at high altitude in the forest, but that's another story. Now, people routinely do this stuff, and in fact, on the backside of the dish, it's just fine. It's a reflective surface, and so the zone that you need to be careful about is fairly close to the dish, the front side of the dish, and so no, you wouldn't want somebody standing in front of it, but I'll show you a photo in a little bit. It's actually hard to stand in front of it when it's operating. So anyway, I think this high-performance SDR project is really neat, and I think it's got all the cool characteristics of an open-source project, and so I would encourage all of you to take a look and see what's going on. And I don't know if you guys heard, there's this thing called SuitSat, where the amateur satellite community put a radio and a bunch of batteries into a news about to be thrown away Russian spacesuit. They got tossed out of the International Space Station and now to slowly have its orbit degenerate and burn up in the atmosphere. And the intention was for that to sort of sit there transmitting for a couple of weeks. And there were a couple of problems with the RF stuff. In the end, it was harder to hear than it should have been. But it still generated an amazing amount of attention and enthusiasm from school kids and teachers and all sorts of people all over the world. So they're going to do one of these again, and they're going to put better quality software-defined radio technology in there. It'll be called SuitSat-2, and you can chuckle when you see that happen. Yeah, community effort. Okay, so the other thing that I spend time playing with that I'll spend just a few minutes telling you about and then we'll quit and try playing with some hardware and maybe try some example is I think some of you know that I build pieces of amateur radio satellites as a hobby. And I do this in the context of this thing called AMSAT, the Amateur Satellite Corporation. There is a German project called Phase 3E and an American project called Eagle that are sharing a bunch of technology blocks, and I've been helping contribute to several of those. But fundamentally, one of the neat things, so you'll notice that there's some similarity in the vision for this next generation of amateur satellites, this vision I talked about when I first started of what we'd like to do with SDR to just plain radios. Old spacecraft linear transponders had this big analog IF signal conditioning block in the middle. And there's all sorts of problems with this, not the least of which is that DC power is really hard to get in orbit. It costs a lot of money. The high efficiency solar cells, the mass of lifting a chassis to carry them and all of this. And yet, we've done some pretty neat things in the past. But you end up with these fairly complex looking analog circuits with lots of shielding and components. This was, for its era, back in the AO7 timeframe, this was an astounding piece of work. But there are a lot of techniques that we can bring from digital signal processing to bear on this. And so part of my personal interest in SDR stuff is that we actually intend to build and fly some software-defined radio transponders on our next generation of amateur satellites.
Do you plan to update them in orbit?
Yes, we're all fully dynamically software configurable from the ground. So what's cool about this thing is every year there's this incredibly huge gathering of amateur radio operators in Dayton, Ohio, Peninsula. But one of the problems with trying to demonstrate anything in Dayton is there are so many people demonstrating so many radio things that it's an incredibly viciously harsh RF environment. And one of the problems that we've had in the past with amateur satellites is we've had great systems until, you know, the military brought up a pulsed radar in the same band and we were within, you know, range of one of the radar sites, or, you know, some guy that's got more money than the rest of the folks, the amateur satellite community, puts up a big honking antenna radio with a big amplifier and doesn't want to turn the gain down when he doesn't need it. And all of a sudden, nobody can hear anybody else. So we're in an interesting little experiment. We took the prototype of one of these giant transponders to Dayton and sat it on the table, you know, some plastic wrap over it just to, in effect, keep people from poking at the board, and ran it all weekend at Dayton. And people walked around the event talking to each other through it and listening to the beacon from around the event. And it's just amazing. I mean, the dynamic range is more than 85 dB, and everybody commented on how nice the audio was through it and all of that, and it didn't get crunched the whole weekend. So it was one of the sort of, it's a stupid way to measure things. It's just sort of, you know, not be able to, you know, speak about it numerically, but from a practical standpoint, everybody that had a chance to play with that demo kind of went, ooh, wow, this is kind of cool. You really can. So part of what we're doing is we find really strong signals that are not of interest in the pass band and we notch them out so they're not consuming the transmit and decide not interfering yet. All this kind of stuff can be done with sufficient processing power if it's all in the digital domain. And it's completely and utterly impossible to implement that kind of behavior in a purely analog system. But, you know, it isn't simple. I mean, this is... Right. I mean, there's a lot of parts on that board. This is a block diagram of it. But at the end of the day, the notion is that we can actually deliver communications capabilities that were never possible before by applying software-defined radio techniques to these things. I'm not going to bore you with a lot of this. Oh, okay. Well, now we're back to things I personally did. But if you want to read up on that stuff, feel free. So you asked about the EME stuff. Yes, this is all descriptive, but here's what the dish looks like sitting up in my backyard. Some of you met my son this week. He's a little older now, but not a whole lot. That's a 3-meter dish on an Azel mount that I built sort of from scratch. It's sitting out in my backyard, and with 500 watts and a software-defined radio transponder, I can use this to bounce signals off the moon. And I'm to the point now where I'm successfully hearing other stations and decoding them entirely using a software-defined radio stack, all the way down to demodulating bit streams for the folks that are using digital modes, or getting the audio of the CW for folks that are using Morse code and having no trouble with that at all. I'm hoping sometime between now and this fall to get the transmit side all put together. I have to stay home long enough in one stretch and not be diverted from my son to go play with model rockets all the time to actually get around to finishing this up. There's a contest that happens every fall that I'm absolutely bound and determined to be on the air for fully operational this fall, so we'll see how that goes. Oh, you all have my radon, right? Best piece of plastic garbage bag I've gotten into so far. All sorts of amplifier bits and pieces, a little shed that I do this stuff from. Anyway, if you want more information and want to follow up and learn more about this, these are some URLs. Again, I'll put this deck out where people can find it. And then, so it's like 3 o'clock now, is that right?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So if any of you have sort of had enough, that's fine. I do have hardware pieces here, and I'll be happy to start plugging things in, and we'll see if we can try and play around with a few things. Find a not too hideous FM station to listen to with an A to D converter and an alarm antenna, that sort of thing, if anybody would find that interesting. Otherwise, I'll be happy to sort of take questions, open this up for more discussion. Thank you for your time and attention, and all that kind of stuff. So.
So, personal politics before we get into hacking. One of the neat things that the FCC has done in the United States is made certain bands available for unlicensed use. So, for example, 5 gigahertz band and
Part
15. And of course, usually the requirement is that there are power ceilings on this kind of use. And it seems like there's a lot of discomfort around that. But I think that having unlicensed spectrum is really a great way for the open source community to experiment with things like, as you mentioned, cognitive radio and more sophisticated kinds of radio. Do you know of anything going on at the global sort of political scale? I'm thinking now work to open up more global unlicensed bands.
Not really. It's not that people are negative about the concept, it's just that there's this perception that Spectrum is an incredibly valuable resource, and it's not completely renewable. It's renewable in distance, particularly at the higher frequencies, and it's renewable if you're using modulation schemes that don't interfere with each other and so forth, but it is sort of a finite resource, and there are large economic powers to work here. Having said that, in the U.S., which is where I know the regulations the most, in addition to Part 15 unlicensed, there's the Part 5 experimental rules. And there you have to apply for and receive an experimental license. But an experimental license can be to do essentially anything on any band. You just have to make a case for why this is something it would be reasonable for you to experiment with and that you're not going to cause unwarranted amounts of interference to other occupants of that band. It's a process you can go through, and I know people that are doing interesting projects where they're operating under a Part 5 license. Then there's the amateur radio service, which in the U.S. is the Part 97 rules. And that, frankly, you know, if it's gotten where nowadays most countries have relatively straightforward processes for acquiring ham radio licenses. And if you actually want to transmit and receive an experiment with modulation schemes, it's not hard to get ham radio licenses anymore. I mean, it's still tough in places like India where, you know, the police investigation of your background is tougher than the technical license. I mention this because our good friend and fellow DD, Ramakrishnan Muthakrishnan, who is maintaining the GNU radio packages before me, went through the multi-year process and is now a licensed ham radio operator. And it was well over a year from the time he completed the test process for the license until it was issued, and even then I think it required some conversations in various directions with interesting people, because they just, you know, it's a country with a different set of thoughts and beliefs about, you know, what individuals ought to be able to do and what the restrictions ought to be and so forth. But in the U.S. and the U.K. and Germany and actually Australia still has a more expensive licensing process than some places, because while they sign the SEPT treaties, they haven't actually implemented the rules changes required to put them into effect in the ham radio service. But as a U.S. amateur radio operator, I can transmit without any funny licensing pretty much anywhere in Europe and pretty much, New Zealand and Japan, lots of other places without an issue. So I actually encourage people to go get a ham radio license if you want to, not because there's 100% correlation, but just because it's an easy way to get permission to get access to lots of different chunks of spectrum. And the use restrictions on ham radio are pretty palatable, except for the desire to not have encrypted streams. But
that's just life.
No, I don't know of any sort of global level initiatives to try and create more unlicensed spectrum. Though I think it's going to happen over time because there's too many users. I mean, think about Wi-Fi. Wi-Fi is a good example. Wi-Fi stuff is operating unlicensed. You don't have to go get a license from your national regulatory body in order to associate with an access point here.
But this license is user phone either. But that's because the people who made the phone license for
you. That's right, because you don't, in that case, you don't actually sort of have specific spectrum rights. You have service rights with a service provider who's licensed that spectrum. And this is where the regulatory thing gets interesting, because, you know, there's actually a rule. The ECPA, the Electronic Communications Privacy Act in the U.S., that makes it illegal to, I forget exactly what the terms are. You're not supposed to listen into mobile phone signals, basically. You're certainly not supposed to record them and share them with anybody else. Never mind that everyone smiles and the politician gets thoroughly embarrassed and having had his phone recorded. But that gets technically harder as they move towards more coded modulation schemes and less just analog RF between handsets.
That's support something that is so successful.
That's right. That's right. And But my point is just that with software-defined radio technique, I mean, there actually was a unreasonable and yet serious proposal in the U.S. Congress that, you know, A to D converters should be licensed. And, you know, this didn't go very far, but it just, it sort of points to the mindset of you shouldn't have any rights unless they're explicitly given to you kind of behavior, which is so counter to, you know, our historical government bias of, you know, those rights are reserved to the states and in theory to the citizens that aren't specifically taken. Yeah, so it's just, this is where it gets tough though.
GSM's encrypted by default, isn't it? Or, I think so, sure. Yeah, that's
true.
It's legislatively encrypted.
Yeah, but I've never actually seen an attack on A5. I've heard rumors of, yes, somebody have reportedly broken the GSM encryption thing, but nobody has actually demonstrated
that. The practical issue is just that you cannot, for example, if you buy a general coverage receiver in the United States that will cover anything from like 0 to 2 gigahertz, it's administratively locked so that you can't receive those chunks of spectrum that are allocated from other phone sources.
And they all have a warning that it's illegal to modify them.
That's right. And so if you happen to find the jumper that you need to remove, or the diode that you need to add, or the bit that you need to flip to turn that feature off, you may in fact be violating the law. So these are the places where, you know.
Isn't that usually on the support website?
Yeah. Particularly the Taiwanese support website. Yes. In general, you know, look, it's not like I care about listening to other people's cell phones. It's just maybe that 865 megahertz is a good IF for whatever it is that I'm building right now. And having a receiver that has a frequency range block is just a frustrating thing. So that's the kind of stuff where, you know, I think this is where I'm actually pleased. When I gave my first software defined radio talk ever, it was at a LinuxConf Australia in Canberra. And it was in the embedded Linux mini-conf. And I actually got asked to repeat it on the last day of the conference in one of the repeated talks. And that was cool, because at the end of the talk, this guy came walking up to me who was from whatever the Australian regulatory agency is. And he told me how much he appreciated the talk, because they'd been talking about software-defined radio stuff on and off for a year or more, and he'd never really understood what they were talking about. And that, you know, I was talking less about hardware pieces then, more about how does this stuff work, and what are the politics, and how do you balance innovation and regulation and so forth. And he was all enthusiastic. He's like, okay, I get it now. Now I can go back and have a useful conversation about this. And then the UK EUG folks, I think it was the time it was in Swansea, so I don't remember who it was, but again, there were a couple of chaps who were in the audience who came up to me afterwards and were similarly from the national regulatory thing. I don't know why they ended up at UK EUG, but they had it. Maybe they just have an interest in Unix, who knows, or Linux or whatever. I had a similar experience. So I feel like, you know, if I keep doing this and all of you go out and do fun things and sort of show people that there are positive, useful, productive, innovative, technical things that we can do that counterbalance the occasional case of somebody who does something clearly reprehensible and gives us all a bad name, you know, as technologists. But that's the kind of thing that has to happen for us to have a nice balanced, you know, regulatory future. So
what would be really great is if we could, you know, create examples or prototypes, ideally in unlicensed spectrum, to demonstrate how a cognitive radio could actually make much better use of the spectrum than conventional, you know, conventional encoding approaches.
Yeah, if you go out and just, you know, do some web searches on various things, you'll find that there are almost anything you're likely to think of in this room today, there's probably some group of people already thought some of that. And if you go poke around, it's kind of like open source projects. There may be a little one over there, but maybe languishing because, you know, the guy ran out of things to talk about or people to talk to. A little show of interest or enthusiasm is often all it takes to, you know, get people to do another burst of work and get something released and make something happen. So, and, you know, look, these hardware platforms are not super cheap. I think this board stack right here probably represents, even at Matt's ridiculously low prices, it's still probably $700 US or something. So it's not really cheap stuff. On the other hand, it's not super expensive either. And it's when I think about people that I know in the amateur radio world, there are those who really don't have any money and are thrilled to get their hands on a basic piece of radio gear and they'll just use the heck out of it. And then there are the people like me who are interested in experimenting and, you know, if it's the thing that's become your hobby passion, you know, scraping up some money here and there to go buy some bits and pieces to play with, or even this little guy, which I think in aggregate I've got less than $100. And again, you can score some free samples and learn how to do a little soldering and things like that if you want to, as an alternative to just spending money. Or just start playing around through SoundCard and doing interesting tone decoding or encoding things. There's a lot of learning you can do without having to spend a lot of money, but the thing that I think is cool is for really modest amounts of money in a hobby budget kind of sense, it's possible to get hardware platforms now that let you do really astounding stuff with open source and a notebook on Linux or whatever.
So wasn't there a TunaFish, PSK, it was like a PSK-31 transceiver that fit in a TunaCan?
There are lots of things like that. There's I'm trying to remember what it's called. There's several transceivers that are like dedicated single band ham radio transceivers. There's one that's designed specifically for PSK-31, runs on 20 meters, makes 5 watts or something. Circuit board's about this big, and it hooks up just with sound cables to the sound interface in your computer and put an antenna on the other side. And so, The only problem I have with it is you really want a fairly decent antenna if you're only going to run 5 watts. That 23 countries in 3 days thing I did at the beach house was because I had about 20 watts or 25 watts. And, you know, I could probably have done about the same thing with 5 watts. It's not that huge a signal level difference, but there's sort of a threshold effect in there somewhere where 5 watts is a bit of a challenge on HF doing PSK-31 and 25 watts is a breeze. So, these are the kind of things that, you know, pays to do a little web surfing and see what people are actually having fun with. Because the one thing you don't want to do is sort of get too ambitious and have the first thing you play with be something that's really hard. I mean, I do this all the time. I mean, deciding to do a moonbound station and just committing to myself that it'll be 100% STR, it'll be fully frequency synchronized through GPS to national standards, and 100% open source. It's probably added 2.5-3 years to the project, given the amount of time I have to spend between business trips and conferences and all that kind of stuff. So, you know, but on the other hand, it's this project for me has been cool because it's sort of all-encompassing, and it's a welding project, and it's a mechanical design and engineering project, and it's an RF project, and it's an SDR project, and it's an open source project. And my company thinks it's cool to send me around the world to give talks at conferences about it. So, you know, at the end of the day, it's possible. I tell my kids, you know, it's kind of cool when you can find something to work on that you kind of get credit for in different ways, you know. Anyway, I would encourage you all to do the same thing.
What is the status with doing something like OpenGPS or something like that? Is it possible, and what? How high are the hardware requirements to use that bandwidth or the encoding technique?
So I actually know a lot about GPS because for in a previous AMSAT satellite thing, I helped to design a GPS receiver that ended up not flying, but that's a long story. GPS is interesting because it's basically time-coded information being transmitted in spread spectrum. The RF part's not all that hard. There is an open GPS project being run as part of the Portland State University Aerospace thing. It's at psas.pdx.edu, I think. See, also Keith Packard hangs out with that crowd, so he can give you pointers if that's not quite the right one. And what they were doing was an open source implementation of the firmware for a particular flavor of GPS receiver that has a chipset. It used to be GEC Plus, and it's now been sold 2 or 3 times. I don't know who actually makes the parts now, but when you're trying to recover GPS signals, there's a huge amount of correlation that has to happen to recover the spread spectrum signals. And what they basically make is a correlator, a chip with a bunch of correlators and an ARM core on the back end to run the rest of the loop. loop closing stuff and signal processing. And they have an apparently at least partially functioning GPS implementation that's GPL.
But that's the only one pure software.
That's the only one I know of in terms of absolutely pure, you know, give me an A to D converter and I'll do the rest. I haven't actually seen anybody do that. I know that there's been some discussion on the GNU Radio mailing list by people who are asking about GPS. I don't, you know, frankly, I'm a little behind on the list. I don't know if there's been any recent discussion. The last thing I recall seeing were people asking questions.
I saw someone on my university writing a master thesis on software GPS. I don't know what came out of it.
That's technically not one of the hardest problems in the world in terms of what it would take to write the code. It's pretty computationally intense if you don't have front-end hardware correlation support. So in something like the USRP, I could see trying to use some of the FPGA to implement some of that. And at that point, you have to ask the question, well, okay, if I'm going to put a hardware system here, why wouldn't I just buy a correlator chip? And this is sort of, I think, the current state of things. But it's an interesting thing. Lots of people ask about Wi-Fi. And there's a working example of a GNU Radio-based 802.11b interface. But the last time I heard about it, it was missing a few fundamental things like power control on the transmitter. So if you actually brought this implementation up and associated with an access point, everyone else would hate you. Get on the access point. And this is actually a really good example of the challenges faced by, you know, trying to balance, you know, freedom to innovate with sort of social responsibility. So. But there are things like that. So some of the other things, just to give you some other application ideas, Eric Blossom, who is one of the founders of the GNU Radio project, perhaps the founder, and is certainly one of the more significant members of the core crew that maintain it, has talked about doing passive radar. Where he lives near Reno, Nevada, he has a house that's sort of on a hill, and in one direction there's a slightly higher hill that has a bunch of high-power TV and radio transmitters on it. In the other direction, there are interesting Air Force facilities. And he has postulated that if you had a couple of antennas, you know, one sort of aimed at the stuff behind you and one aimed out in front, that you could look for reflections. That you, in effect, could get a signature of the transmitted RF from some existing, well-known, licensed transmitter, and then look for echoes of it coming from other directions and use that to build like a passive radar image. I don't know if anybody's ever done that or not. It's not something personally all that wildly enthusiastic about yet. It's an interesting idea, and that's the kind of thing that you could experiment with. There are other people who are very interested in doing diversity reception things, you know, taking the multiple A to D channels, hooking them up to different antennas and preamps. So one good example is when you're transmitting, we're trying to bounce signals off the moon. We have these incredibly, I mean, it's the moon bounce community's equivalent of a big long Debian flame war. It's the discussion about what polarization to use in the antennas. Because when you have an antenna, most of the antennas that you've used before have a linear polarization. In other words, if it's like a vertical whip, the signal is departing with a vertical polarization. If you see television antennas in the US, they're all horizontal, because they're horizontally polarized signals. The problem is that when you bounce a signal off of something else, the polarization gets reversed. So what we end up doing is a lot of times we do circular polarization, where in effect you've got a rotating wavefront. And if you take that, like a right-hand circular wavefront, it bounces off a reflector, it comes back at you left-handed. So it's an interesting concept to say, okay, well, if you're dealing with something like bouncing a signal off the moon, then, okay, it's going to be reverse coming back. That means you could be simultaneously transmitting left hand and listening right hand or something. And maybe you could be doing this without having the two interfere with each other so much, right? The problem, of course, is that it's not a perfect reflector. In fact, the moon's more of a refractor and less of a reflector. So what you get back is not a nice clean reversal of the polarization. You get a messy quasi-reversal of the polarization. And if you're over there on the Earth's surface and I'm over here and the moon's up there, it's not like we're getting what we actually get is, our nice circular becomes sort of, elliptical and mushy. Well, it turns out that mathematically, if you have any orthogonal polarizations, like if you had two antennas, one horizontal and one vertical, or one left hand and one right hand, any orthogonal combination, you can get 100% of the energy that's coming back. And so, immediately the thought is, maybe I should redesign that feed so that I can actually, have really high gain preamps on both the left-hand and right-hand circular sides, so that when I'm trying to receive, I can use two inputs on my USRP and be correlating the signals from the two and getting that extra signal boost of actually recovering all of the energy that's coming back. It's things like that that you can play with this kind of stuff that, trying to contemplate how one would build an analog radio to do diversity reception, where you might have different delays in the paths for the different poles. All kinds of things. At least for me as a software-oriented kind of guy, it seems like a more tractable problem if it's only just broken.
Has someone played using, instead of FPGAs, like a new PlayStation with its cell processor, which would be pretty good for signal processing?
There's a lot of enthusiasm about cell processors for signal processing, and I know people that are pursuing that very seriously in like startups. And so I haven't actually seen a whole lot of people playing with like the PlayStation, trying to do SDR stuff, but I've heard people talking about it. I haven't actually seen any code. One of the problems right now, though, is that that architecture is sufficiently different from things we've had before that it's not clear that you could, for example, just quote, compile the new radio stack and be doing something useful. The same problem we ran into with VLOW processors and other things. You can do really incredible stuff and make them go screamingly fast, but you don't do it by taking existing code and just compiling it and expecting it to all work. So I don't know where in the process people are with that. There's certainly been a lot of interest in it. Seems like a good way to do that kind of parallel processing. Any other questions, or should I try and make some work?
Well, I don't really know much about radio, but my typical, I like to be on, a yacht or something, or on a remote island, that would like internet to work. Is there anything I'm going to be exploring in this sort of area? I mean, I don't need bandwidth, I need it, just anything.
Just need your IRC fix, I know.
Yeah.
Give me 802.11, yeah.
That's hard.
If you've got, if you're in a fixed place and you just want to bring on point to point, the very easy way to do it is if you get an amateur radio license, you will, at least in this country, there's some overlap between one of the amateur radio bands and the 802.11b band. So on a few of the channels, you're allowed to transmit up to 500 watts into a very high gain antenna, and you're normally allowed to transmit 1 watt into a nothing gain antenna.
That's just going to hold the antenna.
So,
you're a tree.
So if you want to do a very long point to point, then you can do a little off the shelf stuff.
Yeah. So I think it's particularly hard if you're in a yacht, I guess.
Yeah,
there are actual people playing World of Warcraft over modems over satellite telephones.
That's a little too addictive.
Especially with those things cost quite a bit, don't
they?
Yeah. Satellite tracking and a satellite link is probably the easiest way to get a yacht. But
that's like what the cruise ships do. It's just expensive.
Imagine the lag.
You can buy HF kit, which will just give you an RS-232 interface, and then you can do PPP over that, and that's the last slide.
However, keep in mind you're not allowed to use any encryption.
Yeah.
Good.
That's okay. Not if they catch you.
Somebody should set PSK31 to IRC. Can't wait.
You're also responsible for content. I'm not sure that would be a wise plan.
It's what a club calls for.
To like send Planet Devin out on slow scan team.
Mm.
Oh wow. I think we're set up a set of scan stations.
How much traffic is flowing on that 44?
How much what?
Sustained.
You can
run SSH in a mode where it's not encrypted, but you are assured of integrity.
You can't actually. You could run commercial SSH. You could run SSH 1 in that mode, but you've never been able to run SSH 2 in that mode.
Can you? Do you know?
Okay.
So
I think it doesn't exist.
Oh, right.
Well, you have to be nice.
You can. You're doing this protocol.
Who cares about the political?
You'd be surprised in that community.
I thought that you, SSH didn't build sort of
encryption.
Can't I just transmit the encryption key first?
Look, I'm the Debian maintainer of SSH.
Oh, now I know how to play.
I'm pretty sure it doesn't have Slacker now, but it's one of the outstanding wishes for us for a long time.
What was this this passphrase for Colin?
Yeah.
What's this about this passphrase?
What?
Yeah,
Colin made it more secure.
So
upstream group, the default.
Who's actually managing that vendor ID as a system.
Yeah, that's like the pre-flash thing.
Actually, I was wondering if this is something SPI should do at some point, is register things like Ethernet vendor address and USB vendor ID and things like that.
That's actually a real good idea.
Address space to folks working on tokens or some projects.
That does sound like a good idea. Aren't you on the SPI board?
I don't know. We'd have to find a board member and have a conversation about it. So, I mean,
sounds good to me.
We're going to see some money for that. They're not that expensive, but they actually.
I don't know if we have money, but Devin certainly does.
They store a fair amount of money for vendor IDs. It's, you know.
And I think vendor IDs require really paying, right? These MAC address.
I don't know, we need to look into it. And you know, the hack that's being used here is not necessarily a bad one, but. This is the problem with not having used this for a while.
So. Well, you got like the without the firmware version, right?
It doesn't run on
screen. Yeah, you run like the USRP or ER thing.
Oh, right, yeah.
This is supposed to, when I gave this package, you did that automatically. You know, plugged it in. And
it's downloading firmware because I've got.
Does it blink once or twice a second?
I want slow blink.
Okay.
Yeah, look, I mean. This is why I'm confused, because the problem used to be that I broke the firmware download, and I got that fixed, and it's obviously working, because we're as fast as
yeah.
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 Okay,
yeah.
So
we're to receive test.
What does the message say now? The message?
It should show a disconnect and a reconnect.
Yeah.
I'm keeping it for you.
So Colin, I heard that the new one will actually connect to different SSHs running in different ports on the same IPs.
Yeah, OpenSSH. Trialstream finally extended to the
number one or something. So I'm definitely going to want to backport once you know if there's a
lot of
specs.
Yeah, we actually
used
the thing a while. Seems to be settling down. I think there's still something on the
chest. Yeah, and then try to. But yes,
this is something
I've been wanting for a
long
time.
It's one port. It stores separate port combinations and known hosts.
Out of curiosity, how come Lee hadn't been tracking the Lee hadn't been we were several versions from behind for a while?
Oh, I've just slapped that's all.
Maybe.
I know that we will try to maintain it unnecessary.
Oh, is it now? Yeah. Is it now no longer zero? Is it 20 miles out 20 more now or something?
No, that's the search of the
data
use the process.
Yeah, but you have to use it. If you want that one.
Right,
sure.
What
was USB?
What
was USB?
It depends. Sometimes. Just really curious, we now use Debian Burst USB.
Yeah, I mean, look, it shows up on our own USB, but
it's
in the firm device, right?
Yeah.
And it's not showing up as the generic microcontroller, so it's done a firmware download and thinks it's a USRP.
Okay,
so now it's a device interface problem.
No.
What?
Disgrace.
As long as you found the right device there.
The program IOCDL. Their kernel is broken.
Actually, that's entirely possible. Oh, yeah, sorry. the only thing I can say, I haven't actually tried this on a 2.6.21. I'm using 2.6.18 still because it still has the key span serial thing. So let's go back and see if that actually fixes it. That would be disappointing.
The live demo.
What are we going to do?
Yeah, demos are demos. Sorry, guys. Somebody reminded me late last night that this was on the schedule today, and I was like, I think I want some hardware.
Can I see the bigger board?
Well,
is that the one that's plugged in?
Yeah, that's the one that's
plugged
in.
Speaking of
the
hardware,
FM radio would only like
80%
of you using some.
I would actually just not mind,
No, but I have one.
You have one?
Yeah.
It has to be dashed.
I used to maintain
these
on keys.
I didn't know.
I just want an edge radio solution for
the
feature.
Yeah, you showed
the
one.
Does anybody know
a user space
package? SR. Or they know it just went
on. Yeah,
it just got clipped. I just have PSPAN stuff built into a couple of AMSAT test stations.
What was the one that you showed?
I looked it up. SDR1000. Yeah.
If you walk in the front door and buy the whole schmear, yes, but
go into the back door and steal it.
No, don't do that. But my point is that's with 100-watt amp and with a bunch of other stuff that may or may not be important to you.
I just want to keep on each other.
I was thinking at some point how difficult it would be, and has someone thought about it? Like, there are a lot of Wi-Fi cards that have injection. So would it be possible to create a driver that would handle the Wi-Fi stuff manually and like span several interfaces and associate to more than one access point on the same channel? Do you know something about this?
No, I got both of them. Okay. That's better.
Yuri, you want to do like mesh networking or something?
Yeah.
Can't you just set up an ad hoc mode to do that?
Oh, well, like mesh networking, but with access point. Like, to be, like, I could have roaming doing really good, so I sent through the most powerful access point, but without the delay of reconnecting access points.
What's the local effort to get on?
92.1.
92.1?
Actually, it's stronger than the one in the previous 95.8.
Don't lack the top of any time.
I heard it's not bad.
Yeah.
Oh, well, just, you know, if we find one more. Say 92 point something?
That's one. 95.8 is probably stronger.
Yeah.
94. I don't know if you can see it.
97.7. Well, yeah. So 100. Like anything around 96 is going to be a little bad. So.
Is the front end written in Wix?
What's that?
Is the front end written in Wix or is it?
Yeah.
It's really crashing.
You could have something.
There's been quite a bit of work in the ways of the prodigy GTK stuff.
How long are you communicating? Maybe you can move it closer to the limit.
100 minutes and it means they're sitting on top of that projector.
Doing everything possible to make this as bad as possible. This is, of course, the overly expensive Radio Shack equivalent of a piece of water.
But it looks great. Yeah, it's fine.
estimate
time issues or
the
yeah,
really
yeah, different
oh, sorry, which is five steep parallel stroke.
That's the problem. The demo programs prefer the chip receiver. It's over there.
So we need a chip receiver.
Oh.
I'd like to use
one of
them.
Nice.
So was that after FB, just after FB suspended their laptops?
No.
No, they switched
the
antennas.
They're not working after you hooked the antenna to the receiver.
Correct. Connected preferred. So, you know what you're saying is that you have a
What's your frequency range?
Is it really getting
for that?
Do you guys get up to 100 kilohertz? Yeah.
What's the frequency range that you can listen with this radio?
The AD converter has about a 65 megahertz sample rate. So you can listen to a 16-30 megahertz chunk of spectrum. But that doesn't have to be 0-30, because you can subsample and actually specifically listen to the alias kind of people interest. So I don't have any, the bandwidth of the front end on the basic boards is several hundred megahertz. I don't have any trouble directly listening just with the A to D or kind of on the other board to things up in the 3-4 megahertz. So it's this interesting situation where you have to think both about the bandwidth of the signal processing components in front of the A to D converter and then also about the sample rate of the A to D converter. You have to explicitly think about the aliasing that's going to go on if you don't have a new radio. Most real radios, even if they're software defined radios, want some kind of bandwidth limiting filter outline so that you're not going to hammer with all of the unknowns and signals and those frequency ranges. And that's why it was impressive when I talked about the demo we gave to Dayton and radio collections, because there's so many strange mixing products and radios. I did a demo there once where in the adjacent booth they were running 500 watt HF transmitter into a woodland. The fact that we could keep the data link up at all was really impressive. But,
so do people filter more aggressively than the Nyquist frequency just to make sure that there's no aliasing?
Well, you have to handle aliasing one way or another. One way to do it is you can.
Yes.
In fact, there are a bunch of interesting things that people are doing. There are a bunch of interfaces around now that have decent A to Ds and B to As. One of the most interesting projects is using is a TV digitizing code. People are using Fermat TV and so forth.
Okay.
It turns out that the A to Ds on those are pretty good and pretty high bandwidth and signal processing that you can run on. You know, they're designed to get high-speed bit streamlined.
Yeah, it's a pretty expensive PCI board, so.
So, yeah. Anyway, Cool. Let's go do some light. Oh, you're welcome. Sure. Always happy to talk about this.
So, can you explain what it was you were doing in Dayton? Was that like a repeater that you were cleaning up, or?
It's a satellite transmitter. So it's basically a receiver, a signal processing section that's regenerating signals and preparing them to be modulated into a download. So basically a receiver, a transmitter, and the stuff that comes together. But we do stuff that you wouldn't think of immediately. Like, we have this problem where our downlink power is limited.
Sure.
And we want really weak signals coming up in the uplink to be repeated in a way that they can be heard on the downlink. And yet, if it were a truly linear system, the guy with the most power in the uplink would get the lion's share of the downlink power. It's the way most commercial satellites work. Well, the problem again is what happens if you have the guy who's got a 5-watt uplink and the guy who's got a half-watt uplink and bigger antennas. And so we actually are doing things like dynamically adjusting the passband gain so that the signal that's down on this portion of the frequency spectrum that we are receiving and regenerating gets more, you know, higher. Basically, we can decouple the amount of energy going to each downlink signal from this energy coming up by shaping an amplitude filter.
It's sort of like taking a geometric mean or something, so...
Yeah, something like that. So basically, because we have a beacon, and the beacon operates at the reference power level, and any signal in the uplink that would generate a signal in the downlink louder than the beacon gets clipped back so it's no louder than the beacon. And if someone is really slamming it, or if it's a radar pulse or something that's just driving it bonkers, it notches it. And so it just takes it out of the passband entirely. So it's this wonderful technical approach to social behavior.
Wow.
You were sending
that. One of the things we've done in the past with a simpler version of this was that if we were too loud, we would impose something.